One at a time.
Give me like 5 minutes or so to introduce it, then we'll ring and jump in.
Yeah, honestly, you just lead it. It's great. Thank you.
Okay, I haven't prepared any slides whatsoever, so I'm just going to make it up as I go along, which is what I always do anyway. But it is a lot easier because at least I've got a book title to explain. Cross-cultural dialogues on homelessness, from pre-treatment strategies to psychologically informed environments. And the editors, Jay Levy and Robin Johnson, which is me. Jay was the person who, he didn't actually invent the concept of pre-treatment, but he was the first person to bring those ideas, which I'll explain a bit and John will go into in more detail, to bring those into the homelessness world. And I was the person that came up with the concept of psychologically informed environments and has kind of shepherded it through its evolution in the 10 years or so since then. But the issue here is actually that term cross-cultural dialogue. And it's the word dialogue I wanted to pick out. Because Jay chose that word as the overall editor. I edited the UK chapters and Jay was the overall editor. Although we collaborated on that, as you can imagine. Jay wanted to argue that actually we are all in the business of dialogue, and it's a dialogue at multiple levels. On the one hand, those of us who are housed and employed and live settled lives, there is quite a cultural gulf between ourselves with our professional backgrounds and our degrees and our articulate abilities and so on. There's quite a cultural gulf to try to understand the life world of somebody who is homeless, let alone somebody who is homeless with multiple complex needs, who's been homeless perhaps for many years, who may come from a culture originally which is different from ours anyway. So he argues that the first dialogue that we have to have is with ourselves and with the potential client or service user is a cultural dialogue, a dialogue between two different cultures. And we have to really work hard as anthropologists, as much as psychologists or social workers, we have to really work hard to understand the world of the other person. Pre-treatment is all about the skills of engaging with an individual you might not have met before, might not see again, in the most constructive way possible. I came across his work on pre-treatment through a chance comment on a LinkedIn discussion. I happened to be just looking at it at the time and asked a question about it. He emailed a reply. He then sent me a copy of a book that he'd written on pre-treatment. At the time, I was editor of the Housing Care and Support Journal, so I said, has this ever been reviewed in the UK? The review we got, my son passed it to a colleague, said, this book is too good to review. You can only rave about it. I since gave all, one way or another, gave copies to other people like Victoria. I see a lot of them here, who, like we said, this changes everything. This actually describes and talks about the skills, the interpersonal engagement skills, in a way that nobody had done with such clarity before. So, great. I was really excited, really enthusiastic to come across this book. And he's working in street outreach. Actually, Fields and Hills outreach, he's in Western Massachusetts. The extraordinary thing was how much similarity there was between that and what we were doing in the UK, in what I saw as the most creative, the most innovative, the most progressive of homelessness services, which is where I was now involved. And so we started talking about a dialogue between ourselves. So that was the other dialogue, the cross-cultural, between the American world and the UK world. And as I was saying in the discussion we had last night, the extraordinary thing was how little Americans heard about what we were doing in the UK and all the dramatic transformations that we've made in the way of homelessness services, particularly hostels work, because they don't use the word hostel. They literally did not hear anything about what we were doing. I actually spoke to people in Boston who said, and they'd done some internet research searching for examples of innovative and creative practice in creating supportive and communitarian environments, And if they came across the word hostile, they would instantly delete it. It's not relevant. They literally were blind, deaf, and widowed. So we're getting really excited about finding the common ground between us. But there's a third cross-cultural dialogue that Jay wanted to talk about as well, which is the dialogue between the worker and the system and the other agencies and their priorities and their eligibility criteria and how often we are go-betweens and translators of the complex, highly personal stories of the people we're working with and the services we're trying to get them involved with, engage with, the eligibility criteria. And what a complex, sometimes painful task that is. So we were talking about the need for, you know, discussions at policy level, and then we started looking at the discussions about the different policy framework between the UK and the US. So I'm going to rush right to it. I've got two chapters that I myself wrote in this. One follows, I should say that much of the, Jane was very keen that we use narratives, we use examples, we use stories about what we'd each done and people we'd been engaged with and the learning from the front line. But he also wanted some more theoretical stuff. Now, I have a background in sort of social work and then social policy and research and so on. So I was a bit challenged by this. So I've got two chapters. I did have my pick in either. One is written in proper research terms, and it looks at the dialogue, the disjuncture, the lack of dialogue of often between research and policy statements, which are very abstract and sometimes very bold, and then the real complexity of work on the front line, that cross-cultural dialogue. Okay. And the other chapter I have is about my own experience going to visit my doctor, as it happens, who was in the States, and meeting Jay and spending a couple of weeks going to visit housing services and support services there, and finding how utterly different it really was from all the policy and research statements I've heard about what comes from the United States, but how the actual lived experience of being a worker, working with individuals with complex needs, you can instantly recognise each other. What came out of that was a whole string of discussions using Skype. Other social media platforms are available. Skype, FaceTime, Google, whatever is, you know. The world is full of people trying to get people talking to each other using the internet at the moment. And the capacity to actually talk to each other, to have these worker to worker situation to see, rather than through these very abstract statements of policy that again is another cross-cultural rift that we need to have. How am I doing for time? Can I get to the
work on that? And over
in a bit, yeah. Okay, 1 minute. Right, great. Okay. John, there's a whole chapter in here arising out of some of these internet conversations we were having where Jay decided, well, let's invite John to talk about how he's using pre-treatment and taking it, ironically, back into treatment, or into the health service at least. We also brought in a woman called Suzanne Quinney, who did some amazing work with hostels in Westminster, all about why is so much of the discussion we have about people's needs rather than about their strengths. It's another cultural dialogue between the way psychologists look at internal processes rather than the social world we all live in. That's another dialogue that we need to have. And a chap, an amazing book up in Newcastle called Ray Middleton, who uses an approach called open dialogue, which was developed in Lapland in mental health services, where you simply tend to put aside all of your own presuppositions and just try and talk to each other, not social worker to doctor, but what I see and what you see, and how we blend all of our understandings in order to try and come up with something new, something customised, something totally personal.
Thank you so much.
Brilliant.